Hello guys, these are your community managers for Dragon Sang Online. This is Haruki.
And Greg.
And today we have a very interesting guest with us. His name is Mabruk. And maybe you know him if you have been in the forums and came across his messages. So if you don't know him, he's our lead artist for Dragon Sang Online. And he coordinates a big team of concept and 3D artists, animators, and illustrators. He has been with the team since the very beginning, so he has seen and all, you know, all the changes that have been happening in the game, and he's a veteran player with a lot of hours in his back. So we are very, very happy to have you here, and thanks for the time.
Thanks for having me.
Okay.
Cool, so let's get started. So, okay, now we know what you're doing, you know, because we work with you, but let's pretend that we don't know anything about this. Tell us, what do you and your team, what do you do on a daily basis?
So, well, we're a multidisciplinary team of artists, and you could easily break down the team into several sub-departments, so to speak. So we got 2D artists taking care of concept art, marketing illustrations, banners and all that stuff, icons as well. Mm-hmm. We got environment artists who create the construction kits for the different locations, but also state objects and destroyables and all that stuff. We got character artists, those are the guys who create the monsters, the pets, the mounts, the armors, the weapons, and all that stuff. Mm-hmm. What else? We got people who take care of the rigs, the control rigs for the animators. We also got the animators.
It's the movement.
Mm-hmm. Exactly, yeah. We got people for the visual effects, for the special effects, and we got people taking care of the user interface. So. It sounds like we were a bunch of specialists, but actually we try to keep everyone involved in each other's work, so just to make sure that nobody idles or something.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So actually one of the things that we get a lot of times asked in the forums is how do you proceed with the process of, you know, an item creation. So let's say that you have a pet or a new mount that you want to create, so how does the whole process start, I guess, with the concept art, and then how do you guys normally follow that line of action?
Well, the initiative for a new asset usually doesn't come from within the art department, but it's rather a request from either the game design or the content designers. Mm-hmm. And they might come and say, hey, we are planning a new event themed around mm-hmm. Halloween. We would like to include a pet. What can you guys do? And yeah, it's not like we would have to create a pet only then. We usually also create artworks for the user interface windows, banners for the social media channels, environment assets, maybe even new monsters. It depends on the request. And but yeah, to stick to your example, we are supposed to create a pet now. And the first thing that we do is basically some research with the other departments. Does this pet have some sort of narrative background? Does it have to be themed, for example, around Halloween? Mm-hmm. Does it have to be of a certain type, like a spider, for example, stuff like that? Mm-hmm. And once this is done, we start with rough scribbles, basically.
Sketches,
idea finding, and this might also already lead to some ideas for poses and gestures in the end for the animations. Once the right direction is set, this is the scribbles or the sketches are then turned into proper concept art. This could either be classic orthogonal views, like from the front, from the side, from the back, mm-hmm. Or depending on the time, we can also create a very polished illustration at that point that can be used for marketing purposes later on, or the social media channels. Always depends. And once this is done, the pet would be then handed over to the character artists, who start modeling the low polygon version of the model. After the low poly model is done, the UV layout is being created, and that basically means that you cut the wireframe into reasonable pieces and flatten it with a rolling pin, mm-hmm. As you do in the kitchen. because then you can lay this out in a 2D space and create the textures later on.
So you're skinning it afterwards?
Yeah, skinning is another term that has a different meaning. at least in the art department, but I'll come to that later.
Okay.
I guess you skinning, you mean like taking its skin off?
Yeah, because yes. When you dissect it, okay. And then afterwards you put skin on.
Well, I was referring to skin weights, but anyway.
Okay.
What follows next is the sculpting process, which basically means that we take the load polygonal model and subdivide it several times. You could look this up on Wikipedia or something. It's basically a technique that simulates a high-resolution surface on low polygonal models. And after that is done, the actual textures are being created, and that ranges from plane colorization to specular maps for reflectivity and shininess, emissive maps for something that glows certain areas of the texture, like glowing eyes or something. Mm-hmm. And also light maps and stuff like that. And all of that is afterwards being put together, and the whole package is being handed over to the rigger, and that guy creates a control rig. And yeah, you can imagine that as adding bones and joints and sinews to this model to make sure it behaves or moves properly in the end. And after the control rig is done, the animators can animate it, and for a pet that's quite a few animations actually. You have the spawn animation, mm-hmm. the despawn animation, the idle animation when the player just stands around, the alternative idle animation for when the player stands around for a very long time, mm-hmm. and you also of course got the run animation.
Mm-hmm.
And when those animations are done, they are finally, the whole package then again is handed over to the visual effects artist. Visual effects in terms of, think of the stardust that the fairy pet leaves behind, or mm-hmm. the dragon breath of the mini dragon pets.
Effects like fire and
exactly.
particles. And
exactly.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, we're still not completely done then, because icons need to be created, the stuff that you can see in your inventory and on the status bar, and the asset also needs sound. And
yeah.
At some point, we also do the basic setup in the database,
mm-hmm.
Because otherwise we wouldn't be able to see the asset in the game and play around with it and test if the textures are good and how it behaves under different lighting settings and all of that stuff. So it's quite a long process, but I mean it's basically the same as it is in other professional game productions. And it's also the same process that we use for when working on the box titles.
Mm-hmm.
And it's fun. It takes a lot of time, but the result usually is great. And that's about it regarding the pets.
Okay.
Well,
it's quite impressive, and that only for just a little pet. So try to imagine what happens when they want to create a new super cool dragon mount or something.
Or just an entire world.
Or an entire world. But we will come to that next.
Yeah, my question, and this is a question a lot of people might think, and we read it in the forums, is the assets that level designers use, yeah? They think that you are mostly behind this, but what's the correlation between level design and the art department? Who creates what, and who uses it how?
Okay, I already mentioned that our environment artists basically create the construction kit for a location. That means floor tiles, wall tiles, trees,
yeah.
rocks, all that stuff, houses. And while they are creating such a set, they also create a so-called showroom location.
Mm-hmm.
And I mean, for Lor'Tac, for example, we knew that we had to create a jungle set and a temple set. And we had several subsets like the Icy Temple and the Corrupted Jungle,
mm-hmm.
that was taken over by the Undermite. And so the environment artists, they set up a so-called showroom, and that showroom includes all of the possible assets that are created for the construction kit. And they also include examples of how to arrange them in,
mm-hmm.
in an appealing way.
That is aesthetic.
Yeah, I mean, just appealing arrangements, how to place plants and rocks next to each other and all that stuff.
So how does it originate? Do the level designers say we want it that way, or do you guys say, guys, we will do it that way, and you please follow?
No, I'd say it goes hand in hand. So this showroom and the whole construction kit is then handed over to the level designers, but they have a different approach actually. So they start with a layout. And for them, it's very important to have the travel routes and the distances between the NPCs, how long does it take the player to go from A to B, mm-hmm. The distance between this monster group for that quest and the other one and all of that stuff. So they start with a very basic layout first without actually building the level. Mm-hmm. And you could imagine this like being made out of floor tiles only.
Okay.
And yeah, but at some point they then include all of the assets that the environment artist provided them with, mm-hmm. and fill the level. And once that's done, and they also take care of monster distribution and functionality for the quest systems and all of that stuff. And once that's done, the map is being given back to the art department for a visual polishing phase. Where we make sure that everything is appealing, mm-hmm. and also for the final lighting and all that stuff.
Okay. So some people would like to know what kind of software you use for your daily work. Of course, there is a lot of processes involved here, as you have mentioned. But can you tell us more or less which are the main programs that you use?
So as some of you may know, we are making use of the Nebula engine, which is an in-house built engine. That was ported to consoles, works in several different operating systems, and it was also used for the box titles back in the days, and at some point it was given the capability of basically streaming everything from online and offering multiplayer and all that stuff to make a proper online game. Mm-hmm. And the Nebula engine comes along with several Nebula engine specific tools that we have to make use of, and one of the most obvious ones and should be pretty comprehensive is the level editor. And I mean, it depends if you know level editors from other games such as a strategy game. Mm-hmm. It's pretty close to that. So as I said, our environment artists are creating those construction kits. We have floor tiles 4x4 meters that you can, you know, set them up in the level editor.
Like puzzles.
Exactly, yeah. Mm-hmm. And then place some plans and mm-hmm. houses. And, but yeah, regarding professional software, apart from the usual suspects such as the Office package or Jira and Confluence for planning and documentation, we are using Autodesk Maya, Pixelogic ZBrush, or ZBrush, however you call mm-hmm. it, and Adobe Photoshop, of course, Motion Builder, but we are also trying out new software if available, like Mari or Substance Designer and stuff. So that's
mm-hmm. that's pretty much it.
Industry standard, I guess.
Okay, so now you know.
Cool. And let's look a little bit at Lor'Tac. Yeah, so this was the biggest expansion so far, and as you can see, it includes 16 maps and lots of new enemy types and things like that. So in retrospective, if you have to look back, what's your opinion about it? Like, how did you guys put this all together? When you got this assignment, what did you think? Wow, like, how are we gonna do this?
Well, without wanting to pat myself on the back too much, we started talking about Lor'Tac in the end of 2014, beginning of 2015. And back then already, I created quite a detailed schedule and a plan of how many monsters it would take, how many pieces of equipment we would have to deliver, and all of that stuff. How many NPCs, how many construction kits for the environments, and all of that stuff. And in the end, the outcome was pretty close to it, and that gave us a rough idea of the final delivery date. But it also led to the fact that we had to cut out several features. And to include as much as possible, we you could say that we adopted this construction kit approach for the monsters, for the Toltec, for example, the evil tribe, those guys actually use the same skeleton, they share some animations, and that enabled us to create three of them instead of one or one and a half. And same goes for the Guardians. So yeah, it was a smart approach, I guess.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And when you look back to all of this, you know, process, which was really long because it took at least until August, so 8 months all in all. What is the funniest part of that creation process? And if you allow me to ask, what was the worst part of creating all that world from scratch?
Okay, yeah, to be honest, at least in the art department, we try not to be too serious because that just makes the job way more enjoyable. And we laugh a lot, and yeah, so there were many occasions that were funny in the creation process. I remember one thing that was where we laughed hard, and it was very strange. We talked about the Orbugs with the game designers and the content designers, and discussed the possible skills for that monster, and the concept art was in the making at that time already. And in the meeting minutes of that brainstorming, we literally wrote down we need some extreme puking and farting sounds for this death and skills. And in the end, they didn't really make it into the game because they were deemed too offensive, but that was definitely a funny moment. And yeah, regarding the worst, that's hard to think of a moment that was that bad. I remember the Claw Strider. You presented it in one of the preview videos, and at some point of the production, we were asked to basically get rid of it and create some alternative. And we already at that time did. It was finished with effects and sounds and everything, and we spent quite a lot of time on creating that. And yeah, that was not so nice, but I mean, then again, we were given additional time to come up with an alternative, so it's all good.
Mm-hmm. When looking at Rise of Balor and the continent of Lor'Tac, what are you most proud of?
Well, me, and I guess I can easily speak for every artist, we are most proud of the positive feedback, basically. Because when you create something that basically millions of players get a hold of in the end, and the feedback is positive, then it's just the greatest joy you can have. And when checking the forums and the questions that you collected, I noticed that some players complained about the Felim mounts, like the lion and the tiger, and they don't like their iron panties. And
and since I really like to react as quickly as possible to stuff that I have influence on, we already took care of that for release 157.
Well, it was mentioned already in the main description about Rise of Valor that you borrow a lot of influence from Mesoamerican cultures, like ancient cultures, the Mayans, the Aztecs, and also Polynesian cultures. Is there any other place that you draw some influence for the final world that you created?
We had several influences, actually. So at some point, when after the rough story draft was done, we knew that we would have to have some jungle setting with temple rooms and all that stuff. And we brainstormed a lot, and we ended up in that Mesoamerican setting. And we, of course, did endless Google research, and but we also watched movies like Apocalypto. We went to expeditions in museums, took thousands of photos. And in the end, we tried to take all of the inspiration that we got and try to transfer it in the Drakensang universe and to create that new setting.
Okay, and talking a little bit about the future, a lot of people are asking about parallel worlds. And Ronnie Finzi from Facebook wants to know, for example, if we will have new mobs and new monsters in the parallel worlds. But maybe this is a good opportunity to just ask you directly what kind of art are you doing already for the parallel worlds, because we can expect a huge rework.
Okay, regarding the parallel worlds, story-wise, they are a distorted mini mirror image of Dracania. Mm-hmm. So that's why it's actually intended that the locations are the same, and also the monsters are the same. And those areas are basically sucked into this vortex that you can also see in the environment, and the player has to prevent this to make sure that not the whole world is changed in the end. It's happening.
Hence parallel worlds.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And yeah, but of course we make sure that the parallel world locations do look different from the originals, and there will be new champions, for example, that will look different, champion monsters, and the random monster enchantment feature that you also mentioned, that will be in there. And actually, we also worked on a difficulty system for the parallel worlds, so you can pick whether you want to go in there alone and have it the easy way, or you can pick the hard difficulty and grab some better loot, but you better bring some friends, because the monsters will be way harder then, and will also, the champions will also have several of those random monster enchantments, so it will be a very tough and interesting challenge. And since those monster enchantments are random, it will be different every time you go in.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, we've been working on all ranks regarding the parallel worlds, ranging from UI, VFX, environments. There will also be a huge new hub for the parallel worlds, which is definitely very nice looking and fits the theme, because the watery grave that you had until now was way too small, and mm-hmm. also those forecourts before each parallel world dungeon didn't make any sense because they separated the players. And so yeah, you can have some you can expect some nice beautiful features for the new hub and parallel worlds.
We've seen parts of it already.
Yes. And just to make you to remind you guys that the parallel worlds, the reworked version, is going to come with release 1.58. So yeah, let's wait for it. Okay, okay. So now we come to the actually interesting part as well of the conversation, which is the personal questions. And one of them would be, which is on a personal level, your most favorite artwork from Drac & Sun, the one you really feel attached to, one reason or the other.
Okay, I guess this is true for most artists. Usually you like the more recent stuff more, because over the years you develop your skills and learn new techniques and make use of them, and that usually leads to the fact that the recent work is better quality. And so, like, I like the most recent stuff more than the old stuff. For example, if you compare the Carlis artwork from 4 years ago,
mm-hmm.
which is not my personal work, but anyway, I was asked regarding artworks, and compare it to the current version, you can pretty much see how we evolved, and that we grew up and got more mature.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, I also like this Four Heroes Against Gorga artwork. I like the latest key visual for Lor'Tac or the Rise of Balor. So that's some very nice stuff.
So, since you've been with DSO from the very early point, you've probably seen the changes that Drac & Sun has made visually. So, from your personal perspective, what kind of changes do you see there? What are the biggest ones that you see?
Oh, I think we've come a long way already and improved in so many areas. Like, if you compare the old character creation with the new one, that's quite a big difference. I also mentioned that it's kind of tricky to push forward visual enhancements though, because usually the visuals are what the players do not really complain about. They like them, and that makes it hard to argue why we should implement some new technique or work on an HD client or whatever.
But yeah, of course we are constantly implementing new stuff like the hero light, the UI sliders for gamma light and saturation. So we definitely made some steps forward and tried to get better.
And we also revisit old locations and try to polish them if there is time. So we are still improving on, in all ranks. And apart from the visuals, I think we made even bigger steps forward regarding the gameplay, because I mean, I don't know if you guys remember that, but when we started with the game, at first we didn't even have a chat for a long time, for quite a long time.
Mm-hmm.
You had to have separate types of essences for each skill.
Yeah.
It was totally inconvenient and crazy.
Complicated.
Complicated, yeah. And Crystals of Truth. So yeah, we made big steps forward, and we improved the game and are still improving the game and trying to do our best.
Mm-hmm. Okay. One question that goes a little bit away from the Dragon Sun Online atmosphere, but it's also interesting, is do you have any advice to give to aspiring video game artists out there? Because I'm pretty sure some people that are watching us would like to know, how did you make it there? How can I get a job there? So this is your moment to, share your knowledge about that.
Okay, I would guess work on your skills, be open to any criticism, and make sure to ask colleagues and friends to give feedback for your work, because if you work too long on the same thing and do that alone, you at some point you lose focus and you don't really know what to do anymore. Mm-hmm. And it's also take a look at other artists' work. I mean, there are several platforms like DeviantArt or ArtStation and stuff. Those are nice sources for inspiration and to see how things can be done. And finally, keep your portfolio up to date and also apply for a job even if there isn't an open position. If you have talent, you will definitely be noticed and remembered. So,
but to wrap this interview up now, mm-hmm. Can you maybe give us a little bit of a preview on the new archetype?
Well, nothing that I can tell you is carved in stone already or something, so we're still in pre-production, and but I can give you, might be allowed to give you an insight in some of our brainstorming sessions. So everybody is aware of the fact that we need another melee class, because we have three ranged fighters, and it's very obvious that we need another melee class that goes into direct combat. And this melee class can't really be yet another fighter with plate armor or something, mm-hmm. Because that would be too much of a copy of the Dragon Knight. And we want some, if we implement a new archetype, we want some fresh gameplay, some new experience. So we were thinking about some sort of rogue assassin class that is supposed to supposed to dual wield weapons. So you could have a sword on the left and a sword on the right.
Or
daggers, or claws, uh-huh. Stuff like that, weapons like that. And he would also be wearing leather, maybe studded leather armor, so he wouldn't be that armored, but he would be capable of delivering like high peaks of damage, go into the combat, deliver high peaks of damage, and damage spikes, and then get out of it again quickly because he doesn't have that much armor. And going invisible would also be something interesting, the sneaky way. What else did we think about? Highly dynamic movement and skills as well, like backstabbing, strikes to the kidney, stuff like that. We also thought about maybe he could be able to empower his weapons,
either
with magic or poison to like add some stunning effects, slowing effects, damage over time. And since you have two different weapons, you could combine those, combine two different magic powers or poisons. It will be interesting.
That looks pretty interesting. I can't wait to see a little bit more of this, but I guess that we have to wait a little bit longer.
Yeah,
when it's a little bit more final.
Yeah, that's it. Originally we wanted to have it for this year, but I think we can say that it's going to be probably a big, lovely, welcoming feature for 2016.
Yes. I would guess it will be an easy to learn but hard to master class, mm-hmm. So maybe nothing for the beginners, but a very interesting class.
Yeah.
For all of those veterans out there.
Good.
Okay, so I think this is it. It was a very interesting interview, and we really, we would like to thank you for giving us the time to answer to these questions of the community, and we wish you a lot of good luck with the next features that you guys are working in.
Thanks a lot for having me. Regarding the questions on the forums, I would have really loved to answer all of those regarding balancing, and I would have been able to. Just one thing you can be sure of is that for releases 158 and the following, we are looking into the forums and your voices are being heard. We already made some changes in release 157 regarding the balancing of the Dragon Knight, and we will keep on improving the gameplay experience.
Just have a little patience. It's a lot of work.
Okay, so cool. Thank you very much.
Thanks.
Ciao.
And see you guys next time.
See ya.
Bye.
Ciao.